is one. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. The Lord be with you. Brethren, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Kyrie eleison,
Christe eleison,
Christe eleison,
Kyrie eleison,
Kyrie eleison. God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory, Lord God, heavenly King. O God Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world. Receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in the glory of God the Father. Let us pray. O God, by whom we are redeemed and receive adoption, look graciously upon our beloved sons and daughters, that those who believe in Christ may receive true freedom and an everlasting inheritance. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, say to those whose hearts are frightened, be strong, fear not. Here is your God. He comes with vindication. With divine recompense, he comes to save you. Then will the eyes of a blind be opened, the ears of a deaf be cleared. Then will the lame leap like a stag. Then the tongue of the mute will sing. Streams will burst forth in the desert and rivers in the steppe. The burning sands will become pools and the thirsty ground springs of water. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter of St. James. My brothers and sisters, show no partiality as you adhere to the faith in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ. For if a man with gold rings and fine clothes comes into your assembly, and a poor person in shabby clothes also comes in, and you pay attention to the one wearing the fine clothes and say, "Sit here, please," while you say to the poor one, "Stand there or sit at my feet," have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil designs? Listen, my beloved brothers and sisters, did not God choose those who are poor in the world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom that he promised to those who love him? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia. 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 Jesus, proclaim the gospel of the kingdom, and cured every disease among the people.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark. Again, Jesus left the district of Tyre and went by way of Sidon to the Sea of Galilee, into the district of the Decapolis. And people brought to him a deaf man who had a speech impediment, and begged him to lay his hand on him. Jesus took him off by himself away from the crowd. He put his finger into the man's ears, and spitting, touched his tongue. Then he looked up to heaven and groaned and said to him, "Ephphatha," that is, "be opened." And immediately, the man's ears were opened, his speech impediment was removed, and he spoke plainly. He ordered them not to tell anyone, but the more he ordered them not to, the more they proclaimed it. They were exceedingly astonished, and they said, "He has done all things well. He makes the deaf hear and the mute speak." The Gospel of the Lord. Throughout history, we've heard various leaders call for some kind of a national unity. Unfortunately, this has been translated at times into the imposing of some ideology, the canceling of culture, the rewriting of history, and with that comes then the purges, the re-education camps, the gulags. We've seen that. French Revolution, time of Nazi Germany, the Soviet Union. We see it today in the People's Republic of China, and I hate to say it, we see some of it influencing our own country. But we as Christians take a different perspective. We don't believe in simply a national unity. We believe in human solidarity. Pope St. John Paul II was a great preacher about human solidarity. After all, he had lived through the time of the Nazis and also the Soviet aggression and oppression during the time when he was just a young man, then a young priest and bishop. In issuing the catechism, he preached, "Social and economic problems can be resolved only with the help of all forms of solidarity. Solidarity of the poor among themselves, between rich and poor, of workers among themselves, between employers and employees in a business, solidarity among nations and peoples. International solidarity is a requirement of the moral order. World peace depends upon us." Upon this. Keep in mind, this isn't simply about material goods or economics or even some kind of universal hygiene, or maybe it's some kind of balance of power. This is about doing what is right for each person. Human solidarity is based on doing justice, being just in all of our actions. It's looking for the good of the other person. It's casting off the selfishness, the imposition of one's own will, be it a person's or even a country's will, upon another, and doing what is good. To have such solidarity means, first of all, having a spiritual benefit for all people, and upon that, then, building the material benefits for proper development. Again, seeking the good of the other. Pope St. Paul VI said, if you want peace, you have to first work for justice. But justice has to be based on truth. Well, my brothers and sisters, this is what St. James teaches in our first reading, or our second reading, his epistle. St. James, remember, was the apostle, sometimes called the lesser or the younger, first bishop of Jerusalem. St. James, though, said, make no distinction between rich and poor, between those who are powerful, those who are insignificant. We are all one in Christ. We're called to look out for the good of the other. This is what we believe. And so there are gospel principles that have to govern not only our lives, but gospel principles that aren't peculiar to being a Catholic or a Christian, but can be accepted by anyone using reason. Now we look to those principles in Jesus. Jesus, after all, is true God who became true man. He is the one who perfectly reveals God to us. He puts the face on God. If we want to know what it is to be a good human being, we look to Jesus. If we want to know how to treat someone else, we look to Jesus. How did he do it? What did he preach? How did he live his life? It's always about Christ. So what would those principles be? Well, the first one is, remember, that Jesus, true God, became true man. Mary conceived by the Holy Spirit, and she had Jesus in her womb and gave birth. So for us, life is sacred from that moment of conception. Now, science would tell us that, DNA. But for us, that life, that child, is a precious gift of God. God has willed that life. That child didn't ask to be conceived. That child was conceived. And so that child deserves life. And so we promote the sanctity of life. To commit the taking of an unborn child's life, abortion, is a grave, serious sin that fractures human solidarity. It's a sin against the child, but it's a sin against the woman who should be able to find compassion, help, and assistance. It's a sin against the medical community who should be trained to preserve and protect life. It's a sin against all of us who neglect those who are in need. So here, you and I have to be champions of the respect for human life. This is what Mother Teresa did. Mother Teresa said, I will take any child. I'll help any mother who is in need. And she has. She has a home in Washington, D.C. But here we have real human solidarity, helping those in need. To have also that attitude of being pro-choice is really a grave sin. Because what are we choosing? We aren't choosing two goods. We're saying that these goods, one good, one evil, are equal. They're equally acceptable. It's like saying, I'm personally against slavery, but I'm pro-choice. And our country was, when we think about it, until the Civil War, that was our country, pro-choice slavery. If the state wanted it, fine. But look, Christians had to even go to war to change that unjust law and to free those who were slaves. So same thing here. An unborn child has a life that is worthy of life. We never know who that child will be. Just like who would Jesus be? We don't know who that child will be. For instance, in 1958, long ago, about when I was born, that there was a young mother who was told by the doctors, your pregnancy is very difficult. You ought to think of terminating this pregnancy. She didn't. In her faith, she did not. Instead, she had that baby. And that baby today we know as Andrea Bocelli, the great singer. And of course you know, not only does he provide music that brings joy to our hearts, he's blind. And he gives hope then to anyone who has some kind of disability. So who will the child be? God has given the gift of life. The second principle then, Jesus came into this world in the context of a marriage and a family. Mary and Joseph, husband and wife, Jesus was raised in a family. If we are to redefine the family. We are going to fracture solidarity. This is a grave, serious sin, because to redefine marriage, redefine family, means it's chaos. Anything can become that. And so, to keep human solidarity, we have to preserve the sanctity of marriage and the family. Third principle then comes in how Jesus lived his life. Jesus had compassion for anyone. Think of our gospel. So yes, here we have a man who is deaf, who has some speech impediment. Sometimes we could say he's mute. And so here we have this individual. But keep in mind, Jesus is in this area called the Decapolis. That's Gentile territory. This man's not a Jew. He might not even know who God is. He doesn't know the prophecies. But Jesus cures him, opens his ears, opens his lips. And what a beautiful miracle. Yes, Jesus showed the miracle to prove his divinity. He showed to prove that he is fulfilling the prophecies. But most importantly, he showed the compassion of God for this man. And he showed us the compassion we're called to have. Notice too, it's really quite a sacramental kind of miracle, because Jesus not only speaks, he touches, he uses like saliva, and in that, it's sacramental. Not just word, but action, but substance. So with us too, when we think about our lives as Christians, if we were to just speak the gospel, but not enact it, that's a grave sin. We have to put into action what we preach. We have to live that. This is why we've had, as a church, so many good organizations, institutions, religious orders dedicated to caring for people of all kinds. Even today, Catholic Charities in Virginia, whether our Diocese of Arlington or Diocese of Richmond, is the number one provider of relief support for all these Afghan refugees. And here, in our own little parish, in October, we plan on having a coat drive so that we can gather coats that'll be given to Catholic Charities, and they're given to anyone who's in need. Doesn't matter whether one's a Catholic, a Christian, or what. Anyone. That is human solidarity. It shows a care for the individual as a precious individual. And then finally, our dear Lord did suffer. He died. But he made suffering redemptive. He gave it value. It wasn't meaningless. He conquered death with his resurrection, giving the hope of everlasting life. And so for us too, when we help those who are sick, the disabled, the infirm, the dying, we're showing that person has value. That person is still precious and wanted. That person is loved. When we pray for the repose of the soul of the dead, have masses offered for them, we're showing our love for that individual. This is the work of the Little Sisters of the Poor that we support. And they care for anyone, doesn't matter who. They will care for anyone. So to say then that this person is no longer valuable, this person is disposable, to say that somehow they could be euthanized, that because they're now in a vegetative state or whatever it may be, is really a grave moral offense, a sin that fractures human solidarity. So my brothers and sisters, we as Christians, especially as Catholic Christians, are called to promote a human solidarity, but one that's based on the gospel, that is based on Jesus Christ himself. So this is our challenge. Sadly, in our world today, there are many Christians, including Catholics, who have closed their ears to the truth. What would Jesus say? He would say, be opened, listen to the truth, cast off the earplugs of selfishness, pride, ego, self-interestedness, and truly open your heart to the gospel and live it. What would he say then to those who are scared to speak? And many are. Many priests will not give a homily like I'm giving. Many bishops won't take the actions they need to do. Many Catholic Christians don't talk because they're scared of some backlash. But we speak. And what would Jesus say? Be open. Do not be afraid to speak the truth. Pope Benedict said that when good people remain silent, evil will prevail. So we need to speak the truth. But then, take it the step further, we have to put it into action. And this is a challenge for us. How do we look upon the world? Do we just simply say, the government should do something? The institutional church should do something? Granted, they should, but we need to do something. Ask yourself, what do you do to help those who are in need, to help build up that human solidarity that is so needed in our world today? I think of a great saint. We have many saints, but this saint, his feast day is September 9th, this week, so worth considering, especially given our circumstances at this day and age. So St. Peter Claver was born in Spain in 1580. Very bright man, became a Jesuit, but he wanted to be a missionary. So he was sent to Cartagena, Colombia. So he went there as a missionary, and for 40 years, his primary work was to help slaves. He was appalled at the slave trade, because every year in Cartagena, at least 10,000 slaves were brought over from Africa, usually Angola, by Dutch and British slave traders, and then placed there to be sold. Now keep in mind, the church, since 1535, had declared the slave trade as immoral and excommunicated any slave trade. And even in the early 1400s, the church had declared slavery immoral and sinful, period. But nevertheless, not everybody listens. Not everybody speaks. So St. Peter Claver was appalled. So he and his companions would go out to meet these ships. These slaves would just be placed one by one, like logs almost, on the docks or in the fields and so on. Many were sick, some were dying. But they brought the food, things like bread, citrus fruit, even brandy and water, brandy to rejuvenate them, and he cared for them. They bathed them, they addressed their wounds and their other ailments, because St. Peter Claver said that we must speak to them with our hands before we try to speak to them with our lips. So after they were able to receive the message, he would then give some catechesis, usually starting with pictures about Jesus. And then he would baptize. It is said that he baptized over 300,000 of these slaves during his lifetime. Now, granted, he gave them a new spiritual life, but also in Spanish colonial law, they were now considered persons. They had rights. They had rights to their faith, to sacraments, to going to church. They could not be split up from their families, split up in their marriages, much different from the British law that affected our own country. So the Spanish law was a little bit more charitable, but nevertheless, slavery was a blemish on the Christian people at the time. So with that, St. Peter welcomed them, and he would go to the different plantations to continue the catechesis. He welcomed them at church, and sometimes people complained. They said, oh, who wants them with us? They smell. They're so ignorant. They're slaves. And he said to those people, they too are children of God, and God looks no differently on them than he does us. St. Peter dies in the year 1654, and thousands, especially slaves and Native Americans, came to his funeral. Here's a man, despite his circumstances, built up human solidarity in his difficult time. The key is, what are we going to do? We need to open our ears to the truth of the gospel message. We have to speak that truth to others with real compassion, but also conviction. And we need then to enact it with our hands. We can't, as an individual, change the world, but the Lord can use us as an instrument to make His world better by building up a genuine human solidarity. May God bless you. Let us stand now and profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, one and essential with the Father. Through him all things were made. Us men for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Dear Lord Jesus, you said that where two or more are gathered in your name, that you'd be in their midst and hear their prayers. With this confidence, we offer these petitions.
For all our church leaders, especially Pope Francis, Bishop Burbage, and our parish priests, that they will preach the gospel with courage and conviction. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our nation, that together we will promote the common good of all, safeguard the sanctity of marriage and the family, and defend the rights to life and to religious freedom. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For justice, security, and peace among nations, especially in Afghanistan, and for those who serve in our diplomatic, military, security, and intelligence services to make peace, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Christians who face persecution and genocide, especially in communist and Islamic countries, that the Holy Spirit will give them strong, keep them strong in the faith, and for all non-believers, that the Holy Spirit will move them to faith in our divine Savior, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the safety of the construction workers and the success of our building project, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our children and teachers in school, especially at St. Agnes, that they will be safe from all harm and strive to do their best, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those suffering from the effects of Hurricane Ida and other natural disasters, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the acceptance of vocations to the priesthood and religious life, that young men and women from our own families will heed Christ's call and offer their lives to Him who gave His life for us, and for our parish seminarians, Tony Bennett, Mike Nugent, James Joseph, and Gabriel Gaudet, and for Ann Whalen and Caroline Jones, postulants with the Dominican of Nashville, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick and homebound, especially Pauline Saunders, and for our deceased, especially the soldiers killed in Afghanistan, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For living and deceased parishioners for whom this Mass is offered, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
for our own personal intentions, which we offer in the quiet of our hearts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we ask you to hear all our prayers, even those prayers held within our hearts, and to grant them in accord with thy divine will, through Christ our Lord. Amen. In calling upon the prayers of our Blessed Mother, we pray. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good, good of all his holy church. O God, who give us the gift of true prayer and of peace, graciously grant that through this offering we may do fitting homage to your divine majesty, and by partaking of the sacred mystery, we may be faithfully united in mind and heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin Mary. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending death, and by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so, with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord,
and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. Agnes, St. Peter Claver, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and Michael our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, my soul shall be healed.
like the deer that yearns for running streams, so my soul is yearning for you, my God. My soul is thirsting for God, the living God. Open God, I shall again be thanking him in the presence of my Savior and my God. Deep calls unto deep in the roar of waters, all your breakers and your billows pass over me. By day the Lord will bestow his blessing, and by night I have his song, a prayer to my living God. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Like the deer that yearns for running streams, oh, my soul is yearning for you, my God, and my soul is thirsting for God, the living God.
mission this weekend is for the Little Sisters of the Poor in Washington. Youth group will meet as usual this Tuesday at 7:30 p.m. Religious education classes begin in September, so if you haven't registered your children, please do so as soon as possible. And we still are looking for some classroom aides. Our Boy Scout Troop 111 is collecting old blessed palms ready for proper disposal by a reverential burning during a campfire ceremony. Please place your old palms in the baskets at the entrances of the church by September 10th. Inquiry class begins on Wednesday, September 15th. So anyone here who's interested in learning more about the faith, whether you're a Catholic or not a Catholic, is encouraged to attend. So please check the bulletin for all the details, and please call the office to register so we can have enough books. And then lastly, on Monday, we celebrate Labor Day, so the parish offices are closed, and Mass will be offered at 9 a.m. only. Let us pray. Grant that your faithful, O Lord, whom you nourish and endow with life through the food of your word and heavenly sacrament, may so benefit from your beloved Son's great gifts that we may merit an eternal share in his life, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go forth, the Mass is ended. Thanks be to God. Saint Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly hosts, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the other evil spirits who prowl about the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen.